The moment that hope was born, and guilt was pardoned once and for all, and captivated. We're moving into the latter part of chapter 2. We're going to begin in verse, I'm going to have you stand out of respect and reverence for the reading of the Word of God. The holy, infallible, perfect Word of God reads in verse 24, chapter 2, verse 24. I want you to see this. The Bible says, as it is written, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord. Father, we pray you bless the reading of your word this morning, Lord. May you touch each and every heart that is here. For it's in Jesus' name. People can't mock God because God is holy. God is perfect. You can say what you want about God, but it's untrue because God is God. But the reality is people look at us and through our testimony, through the way we live our lives, the things we say, the things we do, they mock God. Through you, Christian. Verse 17 is where we're going to start. He says, now, this is Paul, now, if you call yourself a Jew, if you rely on the law and brag about your relationship to God, if you know his will and approve of what is superior because you are instructed by the law, you are convinced that you are a guide for the blind, a light for those who are in the dark, an instructor to the foolish, a teacher of infants, because you have in the law the embodiment of knowledge and truth. You then, who teach others, do you not teach yourself? You who preach against stealing, do you steal? You who say that people should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols and rob, do you rob temples? As it is written, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles through you. Circumcision has value if you observe the law. But if you break the law, you have become as though you have not been circumcised. If those who are not circumcised keep the law's requirements, will they not be regarded as those who were circumcised? Then who is not circumcised physically yet obeys the law will condemn you. And even though you have the written code and circumcision, you're a lawbreaker. A man is not a Jew if he is one outwardly, nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No. A man is a Jew if he is one inwardly, and circumcision is circumcision of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the written code. Such a man's praise is not from men, but from God. Interesting passage. To the average person reading, they say, what in the world was that? What was that? I'm glad you asked, because I'm going to take the time to unpack this for you to the best of my ability, as God would allow me. Verse 17, we'll break it down one verse at a time. He says, now, if you call yourself a Jew, instantly, Christians, when we're reading about Jews, we disconnect. I'm not Jewish. So we disconnect. One of the times I previously preached this passage, I've asked those that were in attendance to take their pens or their pencil and circle the word Jew and draw a line to it. So, and write, put an X, you know, X is, they use that for Christians, you know. I don't know if you know that or not. But put an X, unless you can write out the word Christian, or put a cross and substitute the word Jew for Christian. Okay, because I want you to understand that this applies to us too. People read it and say, well, you're changing the word of God. No, you're not. You know you're not. You're not changing the word of God. The word of God is the word of God, and it's not going to be changed. But if you call yourself a Christian, if you rely on the law and brag about your relationship to God, brag about your relationship to God. Have you ever heard a Christian do that? I've heard people do that. They think there's something special. But you know what the reality is? We are all sinners saved by God's grace. None of us are any better than the other. None of us. And God has saved us from the punishment of our sins. And you know what? There's some people who brag about, I told you about, we're a friend of God. All these songs, by the way, were perfect. We talk about we're a friend of God. The reality is there was a time when we were an enemy of God. But see, people say, well, why would you swap the word Jew out with Christian? I'll tell you why. Because the Jews at that time were the religiously privileged. They were the ones who were raised in the law. They were the ones who were taught the laws of God. they were the ones who had a special covenant relationship with God through circumcision. And so we ask, how do we relate? This is a cool story and it's all well and good, but how does that apply to me? Well, let me ask you something. Who are the religiously privileged today? Christians are. We are. The principles of the Old Testament apply still today. The law doesn't necessarily apply. Jesus said, I didn't come to abolish the law. I come to fulfill.
He says in verse 21,
you preach against stealing. Do you steal? You say that the people should not commit adultery. Do you commit adultery? And Jesus said, if you lust after a woman in your heart, you've committed adultery. Jesus raised the standards, did he not? People say, well, I haven't committed adultery. What about pornography? What about that? Where do we draw the line? Let's look at the Bible and see where the Bible draws the line. You know what? We have a responsibility to walk upright. Where Christians and people at work know that, people in your schools know that, they watch the way you conduct yourself. He says, you who say you should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? Including every part of sexual immorality in that. Throw it in there. Because your example is making a difference in other people's lives. Positive or negative, one way or the other it is. You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who brag about the law, do you dishonor God by breaking the law? He says, Christians, we are hypocrites. We are, because we're imperfect. Sometimes we mess up. And when we mess up, we can always repent. But when you're characterized by that sin, that's another story. I told my kids, I shared this last week, I think. I told my kids, especially my older one who's an adult now, I told her, be careful about what you do and say. When my kids were little, Christy would say, Dad, can you take me to the park after work? And I would always say, I'll try. And she says, do you promise? And I say, I promise to try. That's the best I can do. I was very careful about making promises to my kid because I didn't want to be characterized as the liar who never follows through with his promises. You better watch what you say and watch what you do. When you tell a lie, you're a... When you steal something, you are a... And when you cheat, you're a... And we're characterized by the things we do. So when people look at you, do they say, hey, that Christian messed up? Or do they say, that mess up caused himself a Christian? There's a big difference. Your overall character,
verse
how you
28,
walk. He says, a man is not a Jew, Christian, if he is only one outwardly. Nor is circumcision merely outward and physical. No. A man is a Jew, Christian, if he is one inwardly. And circumcision is not circumcision of the... Circumcision is circumcision of the heart. What do you mean, circumcision of the heart? We'll get to that in a second. He says, by the Spirit, not by the written code, such a man's praise is not from men, but from God. I'm going to read this to you. I'm read a couple of passages regarding this. The verses I just read. The Bible says, in him you were circumcised. He's talking to us. You were also circumcised in the putting off of the sinful nature. You say, what is circumcision? Circumcision is cutting away, physically cutting something away. In newborn babies, it is the cutting away of the foreskin. Okay, so here we're talking about spiritual circumcision. He says, in him you were also circumcised in putting off the sinful nature, cutting it away, getting rid of it. Not with the circumcision done by hands, Jesus says, of men, but with the circumcision done by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism and raised with him through your faith in the power of God who raised him from the dead. Jesus says circumcision is cutting away of that old sinful nature and clinging to the spiritual nature that God has given us. That's what he's saying. Here's another verse for you. For if we who are the circumcision, we who worship by the Spirit of God, who glory in Christ Jesus, who put no confidence in the flesh, once again, it's a picture of circumcision, though I myself have reason for such confidence. The apostle's talking about, again, the cutting away of the old sinful nature and clinging to the spiritual nature that God has given us. Being born again, before we baptize, I love baptizing. I love it because it is the picture of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And the question that you ask, that person before you put them in the water. You ask them, do you believe that Jesus is the Lord? You know, is Jesus the Lord of your life? And they say, yes, I do. You know, do you believe that he died for your sins? And they say, yes, I do. Have you made a profession of faith? They say, yes, I do. Yes, I did. And then you say, I'm baptizing you, my brother and my sister, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. And we're buried with him in baptism. And we're raised to walk in a newness of life until Monday morning when I feel like living for me. Or Friday when I feel like being really bad and I'm three states over and nobody knows me, I can act a total fool. So we can act like we want to, do what you want, but the confidence comes when we live a life that honors God. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord, we come before you in Jesus' name, Father, to give you thanks, to give you praise, to give you honor. Father, we are so grateful for your word, Lord, that's true and never changes. Father, what an awesome challenge to live a life, Lord, that honors you. And so many of us can do that, Lord. The trick is in being consistent. Father, may you give us the resolve and the desire to live a life that honors you, Lord, in all that we say and do, when we're at work, when we're at church, we're in our communities, when we're at school. Father, when we're alone. Father, when we're alone with our thoughts and there's nobody else to watch us, to see what we're doing or what we're thinking. Father, I pray that we'd have the resolve to live for you even then. Father, I love you, we love you, and we praise you and we thank you for this time. Father, I thank you for the challenge of living a life, a godly life that honors you. Father, may we be children of the light and be characterized by walking upright before you. Maybe we be the witnesses that you've called us to be. Father, I thank you for this time. Lord, I pray for each and everyone that's here this morning. Father, if there's anyone here who does not know you as their personal Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that today they would give their heart